everybody. My name is Luke Marr, and this is HauteLeMode. And today on HauteLeMode, we are coming to you with a day three of the Haute Couture reviews for the fall 2021 season. Now, listen, it's a little bit late in the game, but like, it's important to give everybody the time and attention that they deserve. Also, if I sound a little bit sick, it's because I was, but I'm getting through. But today we are going to be reviewing Balenciaga and Sacai. I'm very excited. I'm very interested. So let's get into it. So the house of Balenciaga is not one that Cristobal Balenciaga himself, the Spanish founder, would recognize if he returned to the world of the living. The precious hats he once made have become baseball caps. His name isn't found on just a label on the inner neckline of the garments, but plastered all over handbags and shoes. The prestigious 10 Avenue Georges V has not been the home of Balenciaga's salon, but rather a boutique. And the idea that Cristobal himself would check every garment before it left the atelier is honestly rather unheard of at almost any brand nowadays. But after 53 long years, Haute Couture has returned to the house of Balenciaga, under Demna Gvasalia. While Mona von Bismarck famously wept for 3 days after the announcement Balenciaga would close his house, the fashion world seemingly rejoiced as Demna sent out 63 looks to reinvigorate the sleeping giant that is Balenciaga Haute Couture. Now, I just want to preface the review by saying I will only be speaking about a few menswear looks in this collection. The collection starts with a black suit made up of a rather stiff hourglass-shaped blazer and ill-fitted slouchy pants that pool at the model's feet. And I think in a way, this was the best look for Demna to present as the first vision of the reinvigorated Balenciaga Haute Couture. It sets a clear precedent that Cristobal Balenciaga has not risen from the dead, nor will he, but that his work will be an inspiration rather than strictly followed. The jacket's, well, a bit big, fits well, and curves to the model's body, and the sleeves are beautiful. Balenciaga's personal obsession with sleeves, which he could talk about for hours according to Hubert de Givenchy, was adapted to Vasalia's rather casual cuts. The way that the sleeve doesn't feel scrunched yet is covering part of the model's hand in a way that defies traditional notions of sleeve length is interesting. The pants are perfectly Demna, filled with teen angst and a refusal to wear things that fit properly in a traditional sense, screams, "Fine, I'll wear the made-to-measure suit, Mom, but my pants are still gonna drag." So in reality, as I've mentioned, this is not the Balenciaga of Babe Paley or Pauline de Rothschild, but that is also not Demna's intention, and I think it makes that thoroughly clear here. A skirt suit follows with another hourglass blazer that is no different from the first, but the floor-length skirt gives new meaning to the Balenciaga skirt suit. The skirt suit of the 1950s and the 1960s that is commonly associated with Cristobal is not something I would expect modern customers to think of as anything but costumes. So while I think more experimentation needs to be done on that notion, a long silk skirt feels rather androgynous and yet conservative at the same time. I can't exactly fault the attempt, as it mirrors Cristobal's own work that was conscious of the body but did not overly expose it either. Demna seems to be showcasing pieces that he has sent down the runway before, but in an Haute Couture context. I'm reminded of coats from fall 2020 and spring 2019, and while they're not exactly the same, it feels like a retroactive attempt to recontextualize Demna's references to Cristobal Balenciaga's Haute Couture in a ready-to-wear context that he then must make qualify at the level of Haute Couture. I don't know if that makes a whole lot of sense, but I think Demna is working backwards when it comes to Haute Couture, where a lot of brands have had Haute Couture as a staple or have revived Haute Couture first and then branched into ready-to-wear. But Demna has set a ready-to-wear precedent at the brand and used old Balenciaga styles as inspiration for clothing that is not Haute Couture, but Demna has set a ready-to-wear precedent at the brand and has used old Balenciaga styles as inspiration for clothing that is not Haute Couture, but now must present them at the Haute Couture level. In reality, I think it makes it a bit harder for him to convince his customer of the differentiation between Haute Couture and ready-to-wear at Balenciaga because of his use of Balenciaga's work as inspiration for both. But to be clear, it's a nice coat, and to have a Balenciaga atelier sculpt the coat to a client's body will no doubt delight those who love Demna's work already. Demna then presented a black double-breasted coat with barely visible pants and a large silk shawl that the model carried and somewhat dragged across the floor. I'm unsure of the history of shawls at Balenciaga. I'm sure there were ones made, but probably not in the exaggerated nature of this silk version. But this seems to be Demna's way of creating some sort of drama, although I don't know if clients will pay for something they must carry around, and which will more than likely get ruined for making contact with the floor. A striped shirt in black and white is paired with another oversized pant and a striped dragging shawl. Balenciaga is often associated with construction and Spanish-inspired embroidery, but stripes aren't usually where one's mind goes to when you think of the house. dress. I've seen grid motifs on vintage skirt suits, but was uninterested in the use of stripes on this look until I found a photo of Dovima, the famed model shot by Richard Avedon, in 1950. Dovima wears a thin striped coat by Balenciaga, and I wonder if this is what Demna was looking to tap into. While the look isn't exactly exhilarating, it mixes the exaggerated history of Balenciaga's volumes in a more casual manner that still could speak to a modern customer. It's certainly not revolutionary, but I think being lenient with Demna so he can understand what his customer is drawn to is important, at least when it comes to reinvigorating an haute couture line. And again, I just want to say, I'm not being lenient with him just because he's Demna. I'm being lenient because everybody else already understands who their haute couture customer is from prior creative directors or, I don't know, like decades of design. A black wide-shoulder turtleneck follows, and it was paired with a flared skirt in what looks like a black crocodile leather. But the skirt was actually handmade and is not a leather at all, but rather patches sewn together. Demna's Balenciaga has announced it no longer is using fur as of May of 2021, which could explain this desire to mirror exotic animal skins rather than actually utilize them. And throughout this collection, there are actually not any true furs or leathers, although silks, wools, and vicuna appear, meaning textiles derived from animals are not totally forbidden. But here again, we're seeing that this is not your grandmother's Balenciaga, although if your grandmother has Balenciaga, lucky for you. It will obviously reflect the glamour and luxury of the house's haute couture, but it will do it in a way that is sensitive to the current climate and culture while still utilizing that handcraft nature. Next, a black and white tweed dress in a shapely hourglass figure appears, and is reminiscent of the hourglass dresses and coats Demna showed in his debut fall 2016 collection for Balenciaga. While initially the dresses have sharper shoulders and seem more oversized, this dress feels like a dramatized outer shell, and could easily be molded to the bodies of all different clients. The dress also helps to redefine this common notion of tweed as boxy and baggy and something that can age the wearer, and turns it on its head in a simple yet strong silhouette. And I can't help but notice the sleevelessness, which in my opinion is a beautiful and subtle nod to Cristobal himself. As we mentioned, Cristobal and sleeves, hot mess, the man would have an orgy. Although some could say he was somewhat tortured by them too. And this was to the point that he would take sleeves off of a jacket or dress after it had already been shown on the runway, as he noticed it was not correct in his mind. Something about the frayed tweed sleeves that do show some sort of lining underneath feels reminiscent of many of Hubert de Givenchy's jackets, which Balenciaga would take from his mentee and say he would fix, but unfortunately never got around to it, leaving Givenchy with a lot of sleeveless coats after Balenciaga's passing. A bright orange skirt set follows, and it reminds us of both Demna's and Cristobal's unabashed use of bright color. While both gravitate towards black, this bright orange feels rather necessary to keep the collection a bit light and exciting. The idea of Demna's taking on the traditional Balenciaga skirt suit is also rather fascinating, as it feels very flattening on the body rather than accentuating curves and contours. Balenciaga's skirt suits also didn't exactly follow the curves and swerves of the body, and utilizing a less dense fabric rather than the traditional tweed is also rather sweet. The somewhat off-the-shoulder jacket, which also creates a hump in the back of said jacket, is something we saw during Demna's debut collection as well. Again, we can see Demna's ready-to-wear trickle into this haute couture collection. While Balenciaga's own ideas of experimentation with the form take shape again in these humpback jackets. While many might see the side profile silhouette as odd and unshapely, Balenciaga's baby doll dresses and envelope dress were also seen as strange at a certain point as well. A blue denim humpback set follows, and was somewhat controversial, at least when one thinks of what normally is associated with haute couture. But denim is part and parcel of everyday life now, and while it has been seen by some as quote working class attire, there have been denim makers that put real and true craftsmanship into each and every pair they make. Japan has become an epicenter for denim, and certain makers like Momotaro can go for as much as $2,000 and are made to measure. And Demna recognizes this and has sourced Balenciaga's denim from the country, where the textiles are usually made on Japanese looms and have hand-dyed techniques too. While it's easy to dismiss a fabric like denim as not haute couture, it's harder to reconcile with the complexities and nuances denim culture and fabrication have taken on since the end of the Second World War. Demna's using of a signature silhouette with a high-quality fabric like Japanese denim again plays to this refusal to play by the rules, which is also what has made him a success at Balenciaga. And I have no doubt customers will gravitate towards the denim pieces. If you're gonna pay that much for it, you more than likely want it to be worth the money. And something you can wear the shit out of. An off-the-shoulder humpback trench coat follows and is again cementing that silhouette. The fit of the trench coat is not similar to traditional cuts, which are quite oversized and give the wearer a lot of room. But because of this restrictive fit, it also allows the exaggerated back yoke or back flap to create a capelet-like effect. I suspect Demna is referencing many of the capelet styles that Cristobal showed throughout the years and incorporates these Cristobal tropes without it feeling like it's the 1950s again. Nor does it really make it that whole sort of like priest, Catholic uniform feel either, which was a Balenciaga sort of inspiration. Baggy jeans were paired with an off-the-shoulder coat, which one might suspect is made of gray feathers. An image by Irving Penn depicting a Balenciaga look with cocoa-colored feather skirt from the fall 1950 collection might be the reference that Vuitton was tapping into. Again, we are met with the imitation animal skins, as these are, quote, feathers, made of silk, not actual bird feathers. But to the unknowing eye, one would never know the difference. It's a lovely jacket and one that clients will more than likely flock to, like birds of a fake feather. A humpback look once again follows, which is letting the cement of the silhouette harden for clients, and is made in a black pant set with white polka dots. Balenciaga himself had an affinity for polka dots. There is a dress that looks incredibly similar from 1954, and Demna has tapped into that during his ready-to-wear collections over the years too. The set is not particularly dazzling in cut, but then again, I'm willing to give Demna time to develop his own ways of interpreting the signature print. And as for the bow, it also seems to tie back into Balenciaga's own love for draping as well as bows, but doesn't uplift the look in any particular way. Another silk feather look arrives, this time a coat with stiff collar, and when mixed with the Philip Tracy designed hats, it exuded that grand yet terrifying nature that many of Balenciaga's looks delivered. A black leather fitted trench coat with back yoke followed, but didn't have the same gravitas as the last trench. Something about it, whether it was the model or the fact that the leather didn't reflect the shapeliness that Demna was going for, made it fall flat. And I don't just mean in terms of like the cut. I think Demna in this regard needs to take another page out of Balenciaga's playbook. Cristobal always used the fabrics as the foundation for a garment. And so if Demna wants to use leathers, or faux leathers in this case, he's going to need to spend time sourcing some that will allow him to command it, or at least work with it, rather than what looks like work against it. If Cristobal could develop silk gazar, Demna should have no problem developing a leather that will do his bidding. A Aran knit sweater follows and is paired with a white shirt and slouchy jeans. The sweater is actually made of chainmail, which is very Demna-esque. I mean, like, remember the whole Knights of the Round Table shoes from a couple of seasons ago? But I'm not sure customers will bite when it comes to styles like these, so maybe it's best Demna uses them as showstopper looks in the same way Balenciaga used Spanish-influenced embroideries. What looks like another fine chainmail look arrives in a slip dress cut with a slight dragging train. What looks like a small side gathering at the back of the dress seems to add that train effect, but overall the dress is very simplistic. A wraparound draped cocktail dress in black is covered in silver sequins and makes it evident that this is where Demna needs to work on his draping. While it's commendable to try and recreate the strong wrapped necklines of Balenciaga, the dress just feels uninteresting. Demna must acquiesce to his clientele, and that is understandable, but Balenciaga is a house about innovation and must be taken into account. If a client wants to adapt a radical draped gown to suit their own needs in the salon, I get it. But Demna should not kowtow to that on the runway. While the sequins speak to this sort of trashy 1980s aesthetic that Demna has recreated, I wonder if doing a radical take on Spanish lace wouldn't have created a far more dramatic effect here. Another polka dot dress is in effect, but the way it's draped feels more young gay child wrapping themselves in their bedsheet and putting a belt over it. Again, Demna's structure is strong, but the draping is where he's evidently lacking, and that has to be corrected as time goes on. Cristobal took such care with each look he showed on the runway, and Demna would set himself apart from his contemporaries if he really truly focused on this aspect of the business for at least a few seasons, until he's confident he's found the right methods and pacing in which he can then go back to focusing on other aspects of the business. I understand today's Balenciaga is nothing like the Balenciaga of years ago, but that doesn't mean the care in terms of haute couture should falter. The black velvet pants set has a conical shape, which is sometimes referred to as a funnel neck. Alexander McQueen's spring 2007 Saraband collection is one of the most notable examples of the silhouette in use, but Demna gives it a much more minimal and dark feeling. Demna then introduced a black silk dress that seems as if it has been reversed on purpose. The collar reaches to right below the neckline, almost forcing the wearer to have good posture, which is actually a rather smart way of utilizing design to make the wearer hold themselves. themselves. Of course, clients can adapt pieces however they want and could easily reverse it so the front becomes the back, and the little scoop neck back detail becomes a neckline. While of course no haute couturier would ever dare to send out a wrinkly gown, especially at the point where Cristobal was still showing collections, but that again is where Demna spins the notions of haute couture on its head. A gown that is full of wrinkles is to many the last thing you would consider perfection, but Demna is never afraid to rewrite house codes or defy the status quo in order to push the envelope. Dress. I think it's a beautiful garment, and the wrinkles would require those in the know to truly understand Demna's aesthetic and processes. A strapless black gown is full of embroidery that creates circles of plastic-like petals. It feels a bit clunky in terms of fit, but I can't deny that more traditional clients might look to styles like these. A sleeveless gown in what looks like a dated cream or ivory silk is covered in a vibrant pink floral embroidery. The gown looks as if it's really just been pulled from the Balenciaga archives and sent down the runway, and I'm sure it's Demna trying to keep some of the classic Balenciaga elements. And it's so interesting to see the skirt move, while the bodice is so incredibly rigid as the model walks. A black gown that is gathered in an upward spiral is rather lovely, and the mermaid silhouette is something that Demna does rather well. The sleevelessness is rather pronounced, and the armholes move farther back into the torso rather than being at the top of the shoulder like previous looks. The gathering of the dress is a bit edgy without feeling unsophisticated, and the use of black lace is exactly what Demna should be doing with a fabric as important to the brand as lace is. A black asymmetrical coat in the shape of a mermaid silhouette with long and capturing lapel and collar then follows. It is more than likely a reference to Balenciaga's 1962 cape coat, which was made in a moss green in silk gazelle. Demna no doubt put his own spin on this new version by adding utilitarian pockets at the bust, which we can discuss further in a bit. I'm unsure of the fabrication, I just presume it's some sort of silk, but in reality, overall, it's just a nice and smart rendition of the original coat. A blue coat follows, this time with slightly dramatic train, and overall feels like a take on a Balenciaga opera coat. And again, Demna incorporates these utilitarian pockets, which one would see on a workman's jacket, but makes them oversized and uses the space between them to accentuate the waist. I won't say it's the smoothest incorporation, but it melds Demna's love for workwear with that Balenciaga grandeur. A gigantic black floor-length coat looks like it's been made of shaggy fur, but more than likely is made from some sort of yarn-like fiber. Not only does the coat flare theatrically, but the whole coat feels like the perfect winter wear. A blue wrap gown with plunging neckline and bold collar and an electric blue silk feels a bit ill-fitted. The sleeves are too big, while the wrinkles of the torso and the belt don't feel intentional like the gown we saw earlier. This is one of the looks that needs to be fine-tuned. A massive pink coat has an operatic feel, but with a slight hint of that 1980s sportswear in that button-up collar. Again, it's respectable to see Demna put his own aesthetic into looks like these, but it's also gonna need to be rethunk in order to really hit home. A wrinkled green silk cape follows and might be a reference to a pink cocoon-shaped coat from 1951. Balenciaga, the house was founded in 1937 in Paris, but in 1919, Balenciaga's first brand, Isa, was born in San Sebastian, Spain. During this time in the 1910s, fashion designers like Paul Poiret and Mariano Fortuny were heavily inspired by what was then dubbed Orientalism, or the appropriation of techniques, textiles, and silhouettes of the Orient, commonly known as Asia. Here it seems that Demna is trying to exaggerate this opera coat's features, as the sleeves and gathering is rather bulbous, and not in a traditionally flattering way. Something about Demna's collection wants to make the back almost protrude, and look at the way we see what many would call tech neck. Is it trying to look at the way that the human body will adapt to what is called tech neck, and the way that our posture has begun to slant due to constant technology use? As for my tech neck theory, I'm not sure, but I am sure that the cape is probably a reference to Poiret, who used kimonos as inspiration for his own versions of the cocoon coat, which inspired Cristobal Balenciaga immensely. In Demna's own subversive manner, he created one of the most intriguing looks of the collection, where Cristobal himself was inspired by the 19th century bustle, which accentuated the butt area with exaggerated skirt. Demna reverses that. Here, Demna shows an embroidered silk gown with bateau neckline that in the front is floor length, but at the back stops right at the top of the hips, which exposes a pair of black slacks. From the front, one would never be able to tell it wasn't a full gown, which plays into Demna's somewhat subtle shock value. And the black pants at the back showcase that the gown is really only a front-heavy top, while also noting that the modernization of women's wardrobes since the late 1960s and how far it's come. In traditional haute couture fashion, Demna finished the collection off with a bridal gown. The gown is covered with a white veil that covers the model's whole face and the bodice of the dress, but we can see that it is sleeveless with a mock neckline. Demna noted that the dress was inspired by a wedding gown that was one of Balenciaga's last, and more than likely is based on the iconic single seam 1967 wedding gown, which also happened to be inspired by Paul Poiret, who used a lot of single seam styles, but I digress. The shape of the torso is the same, and it also encompasses the use of seams to create shape in the train as well. I wish Demna hadn't covered the gown up though, as it takes away from the construction and fabrication of the piece, and ended the collection on a quite morbid note, instead of feeling joyful and pure, but also like that's kind of Demna, so like, I get it. Now, Demna's Balenciaga is something I've been sitting with for a while, because obvious reasons, aka the timeline of this video, but it also was hard to process how an icon like Balenciaga could be succeeded. For years, it was a ready-to-wear house only, and it also felt like the right way to honor such a genius. But now that the Pandora's box has been opened, I don't necessarily mind it. I think Demna is never going to be Cristobal, but that also shouldn't be the expectation. And already, Demna has begun to twist and turn the house's haute couture awakening in a manner that is subversive and controversial and experimental, and like, that's pretty Balenciaga-esque. He understands who the modern Balenciaga customer is, and while bringing them pieces that they will easily understand and fawn over, he is also giving them a very subtle history lesson about Cristobal Balenciaga. Because Lord knows, people that buy fashion don't often know a lot about the brands. It is incredibly easy to besmirch the haute couture legacy of Balenciaga, and I think instead of diving headfirst into the deep end, Demna is wading carefully and thoughtfully into the body of water. And I won't be dreading the next collection, which is a very good thing in my opinion. Now let's discuss Jean Paul Gaultier. Chitose Abe is not a household name like many of the brands we have discussed while reviewing haute couture collections, and the Japanese designer's own brand Sacai isn't exactly the most well-known either. But that doesn't mean she isn't a darling of the industry, and her collaborative debut for the house of Jean Paul Gaultier was rather fun and didn't lose her reconstructionist ideals, and yet didn't forfeit Gaultier signatures either. I will say, in no way am I a Gaultier head, nor will I act like I am, but I do think that this collection held its own when compared to other Gaultier collections, and felt like a remix rather than a rehash. The collection started off with a pinstripe ensemble, which is a motif Gaultier has been playing with for at least 30 plus years. Abe created a sheer pinstripe dress with buttons, collar, and full sleeves as a way to reference traditional men's suiting attire, but then her signature reconstructionist aesthetic combined a men's suit jacket turned corset with a silk seamed bra top. While more pinstripe fabric scraps come together to create a dramatized skirt overlay that resembles a French panier by exaggerating the hips. It's a rather brilliant way to contextualize a Gaultier trope without it feeling like something we've already seen from Gaultier. And it also is the kind of start a collection should have. It's not giving away all the secrets of the collection, but it immediately creates intrigue and compels the audience to want to see more. What looks like a column dress in three different parts follows and feels more Sacai, and showcases that this isn't solely a Gaultier collection. The juxtaposition of fabrics that are unexpected, like this somewhat sheer tank top, that is met with another of these seamed bras, which we'll talk about in a bit. And the high-waisted but loose skirt is daring, but signature Sacai. While many might see pieces like these as unwearable, Sacai has a strong customer base, and is a disciple of Rei Kawakubo's aesthetic, where odd is looked upon with intrigue rather than disgust. Then a deconstructed pinstripe suit with flare pants arrives with a transparent pussy bow blouse that was kind of long in length and then had sort of like a train that flowed behind the model. Now Gaultier has deconstructed suits in this manner before, and Abe brought a diaphanous feeling with it through the sheer top, and it felt kind of new and exciting. Next came a deconstructed trench coat that again created this sort of ball gown shape, but was really just a bodysuit with attached faux skirt. One can also see the tattoos on the model's body, which really are a printed bodysuit and a reference to one of Gaultier's most famous pieces, the tattooed mesh. Gaultier's spring 1994 ready-to-wear collection titled Le Tatouage debuted sheer tops that were covered in tattoo-like motifs and have become a cult fashion classic that is still desirable and commanding high prices to this day. Abe recreated the motif in a constant blue and can be seen as an undergarment throughout most of the looks in the collection. A gray rib knit turtleneck sweatsuit is covered in hand-pleated organza ruffles, which does create a dress-like shape. It is also covered in white embroidery that does feel reminiscent of the motifs found on the tattoo catsuits. While I appreciate the experimentation, it falls flat in comparison to the previous looks though. A completely strapless trench coat gown in beige then arrives with double buttons and pockets up the front. Its high-low effect is rather playful and has a childlike innocence to it, but also adds a bustle-like effect at the back. So Gaultier has referenced crinolines multiple times in his work. While this is a bit more exaggerated, Abe seems to have the right idea. Green bomber jackets have been recreated into a sleeveless cape and mermaid silhouette dress that only reaches the knee. It also has the accentuated seam bra, which Abe admits was pulled from Gaultier and Madonna's collaboration for her Blonde Ambition tour. You know, the cone bra. Bullet bra. Now, taking bomber fabrics and recreating them into a dress is signature Abe and Sacai, and proves that she is again not overtaken by the waves of Gaultier. A bomber bodice and mermaid skirt then follows, which could have been a lot better executed than it actually was. The way that the bodice sits on the top of the skirt makes the waist of the skirt sort of pool over, which isn't super flattering. And a jacket seems to have inner straps that allows it to act as like a backpack, but the enfant terrible in rhinestones on the straps are less than appealing. Much more less. It's not hard to understand the reference to JPG as l'enfant terrible of fashion for his wicked sense of humor and pretty shocking collections, but it's better left unwritten on the clothing, in my opinion. It's just, let's let him be l'enfant terrible in speech rather than on clothing. And now the skirt flare utilizes seams to create pockets and godets of their own, which is nice, while the orange that is exposed is an obvious reference to the MA1 jacket lining, which was to help pilots be noticed in case of crashing. So yes, bomber jackets, not just a fashion statement, but a historical and militaristic garment. A deconstructed and asymmetrical pinstripe bodice arrives with one sleeve, safety pins, and studs. It's most likely riffing on Gaultier's love of punk aesthetics and mixing more feminine and masculine tropes in the process. A parka dress in pinstripes was one of the most exciting and refined looks of the collection. A bone corset with seamed bra captures that blonde ambition energy, but the parka, which is a slim fit till it hits the top of the hips, is breathtaking. The skirt of the parka is then filled with down and sewn at three different levels to imitate tears, which has a feeling of like Charles James meets Pier Paolo Piccioli for Moncler in the best way possible, and not referential, I'm just saying. It's what it reminds me of, that sort of bringing in of parka and high fashion silhouette. And the pinstripe hat, which is no doubt based on a trapper hat, is the perfect touch. Beautiful. An Aran knit dress isn't really, well, an Aran knit dress, but it is one of the best looks in the collection. This is the perfect melding of Chitose Abe Sacai and Jean Paul Gaultier's aesthetics without feeling too dominant on either side. Essentially, there is a mesh dress in which different size panels or swatches of a white knit is placed to look as if it's been patchworked. It's really based on Aran knits, which are specific to the Aran Islands off the coast of Ireland, which Gaultier explored for his fall 1985 collection and made an emphasis on the breasts in conjunction with his exploration of the bullet bra. The way that the patchwork of the knits sits so that there is space between them has this Sacai reconstruction feeling and possibly a reference back to her own debut collection in 1999, where she made just 5 knit looks to present. If Abe was to become a permanent addition to Gaultier, which unfortunately it seems she will not, these are the types of explorations I would expect and be grateful to see unfold. Also, the fact that Pierre Hardy, the beloved shoe and accessories designer, created Aran knit knee-high boots only adds to the brilliance. Another Aran knit inspired look arrives and has a more pronounced Gaultier feeling, as it's not totally deconstructed, but rather a sickly sweet gown full of braids, pom-poms, and fringe. It is attached to mesh, as we can see the sleeve, collar, and dress are in fact detached, and the fringe might be a way to establish an air of deconstructionism, like Abe almost forgot to have her team finish knitting it. It's a gorgeous dress, no ifs, ands, or buts about it. Another parka style arrives, this time a Gaultier runway reference to when he had Bjork, the famed singer, don what looked like an animal skin dress or jacket with fur piping and a JPG logo. Abe's take on the dress doesn't update the silhouette or even deconstruct it, but rather adds rhinestones and what looks like cheaper material, which in reality makes the look fall considerably flatter than the original. This is where pulling references from the archives becomes too dangerous, as if it's not updated enough, it feels like a sad rehash of ingredients from yesteryear. A denim jacket follows with a fitted military-inspired torso with buttons lining the placket and back pockets as shoulder details, which was honestly rather smart. The bottom is an exaggerated silhouette like all of the previous looks we've seen, but made using jeans which bring back the sort of reconstructionist ideals. A sister jacket follows and has a deconstructed back that cuts off and exposes the fact that the back is made of legs of jeans to create a pleated effect. Brilliant. It's brilliant. This is what I want to say. Decorative navy attire is then co-opted in a black jacket with gold embroidery and oversized white shorts with double buttons. This is more than likely a take on Gaultier's famed Breton stripe, which originated in the French Navy before the turn of the 20th century. And it was then adapted by Gaultier to become a cult symbol for his brand. Now, Abe is indirectly referencing navy uniforms without making the styles just slapdash Breton stripe. It's rather lovely and another smart way to play on Gaultier tropes, but make them her own. A black gown with high slit and gold embroidery and buttons is definitely a play on recontextualizing styles, but their dress does fall flat. And while it does have that Sacai feeling of rearranging garments into something different, it doesn't feel new or experimental, leaving it just rather underwhelming. The signature Breton stripe emerges in an oversized sweater consisting of small strips of frayed fabric layered on top of each other. It's also a perfect way for Abe to insert her work into a Gaultier classic, and as one descends down the sweater, you can see that the diaphanous fabric turns itself into an asymmetrical train top. The Pierre Hardy plaid boots also play into the punk aesthetics we discussed earlier. Another Breton stripe sweater emerges and falls into a plaid high-low skirt that actually eclipses the width of the sweater. In a strange way, Abe has woven together Celtic history, as the Bretons were a group of Celts that lived in southwest France. While the plaids or tartans seen are descending from Celts who lived throughout England and Scotland and Wales and Ireland, and I'm not saying that all the other people besides Scotland had tartans. I'm just saying plaids in general, okay? Because I know the Scots are gonna be in the comments very upset and I won't be able to understand even through text. And I'm joshing Scottish people, I'm a stan. Also, just for reference, but I'm unsure. A yellow plaid look emerges with the frayed chiffon panels descending downwards and a barely there leather jacket reigniting the punk vibes. And honestly, it could be a little bit more exciting though. A black blazer ball gown dress emerges and feels like a mixture of traditional masculine and feminine tropes, which combine Gaultier's gender fluid approach with Abe's D and reconstruction. And now, yeah, it is kind of like simple, I guess, in terms of other things, but it's nice and it's clean and it's classic, but it's not really classic, so that's fun. A sheer top is then paired with a black boy short that has been sewn to have the waistband look as if the shorts are actually wider than they truly are, but the enfant terrible shirt is also not helping whatsoever. A silk slip dress with large slit up the middle has a sweatshirt sutured to it to seem like it's been tied around the waist, which like I get, but it's kind of lacking, especially for the second to last look of the collection. The finale is a sleeveless boiler suit with exposed panier at the waist that creates a more feminine silhouette. And in reality, it's juxtaposed against that sort of traditional masculine feeling of a boiler suit and their lack of shape. Now, Abe would have been suited playing on the tradition of a wedding dress, as it would have been so interesting to see a reconstructed style of that nature through her eyes, though. Cause like, Chitose, I would have loved to see it. I would have been enjoying it. I would have wanted to catch the bouquet at the reception. Overall, Sacai and Jean Paul Gaultier's collaborative Haute Couture collection was smart, referential, and melded together to provide a strong link between the two brands' aesthetics. One can hope that this would become a permanent collaboration, as Chitose Abe being able to further explore the Gaultier archive and her own design ethos in a more concentrated study would be interesting to see. So one can hope and or manifest. But that is the end of today's video. I'd love to know what you guys think in the comments down below. Did you love the new Balenciaga? Are you obsessed with the idea of Jean Paul Gaultier collaborating with cool, interesting brands in the future? I want to know. I will see you guys in the next one. Thanks so much, and TTYL.